A lot of you have already turned in your exam reflections. If you didn't get to that on your way in, you can just turn them in on your way out up front. You get to keep your exam with you. You don't need to turn that in. There is a homework assignment due on Wednesday that's going to draw on the material from today. Hopefully I'll get through enough of it that you can do it over the weekend. If not, then you'll have to wait until after Monday. Right now, actually, a lot of the questions that people sent me were about sort of this unit, and so why are we spending time? If you look in a textbook, and if you look in your textbook, you can do this and you can cheat and whatever, and that's fine. There's a general consensus that's been reached about, for the hippocampus, what goes on with long-term potentiation. But part of the reason why we're working through this isn't just so I can tell you at the end of the day what happens with long-term potentiation, because I find that a boring thing to do. Then that is why biology gets this reputation of being this discipline that's all about memorization. One of the reasons why we're spending an entire week answering a question that I could answer basically with a single word, actually 2 weeks really answering a question that I can answer with just a couple of words, is because it took a decade for neurophysiologists to answer this, and literally millions of dollars and centuries of human time, if you add up the years, every person and all the years each person put in to trying to answer this question. Why did they dedicate all that time to it? Part of it probably has to do with people's ego. They got a little bit like caught up in their ideas about how things worked, and then started literally yelling at each other when they came to different conclusions. But ultimately, the motivation for doing it at the time was really to get an understanding of the physical basis of memory. We know that the hippocampus is this structure that's critical for the formation of certain types of memories, those kinds of memories that you can explicitly tell me about, things that happen to you, facts that you can tell me. And we want to know what the physical basis of that is, in part because memory is this fallible thing. There are diseases that can destroy memories. And if we don't know what goes on at a cellular level with memory, then we stand a really, really poor chance of finding ways to fix errors in memory. If we do know the physical basis, that doesn't guarantee we're going to have a way to fix it, but at least we can intelligently try to fix problems with memory. So that's one reason why this became such a sort of critical, heated question. Another reason why I find this to be an interesting and worthwhile topic to spend a lot of time on is not just because of the final answer about whether long-term potentiation is because of an increase in AMPA receptors or an increase in release from the presynaptic terminal, but in the process of trying to answer this question, synaptic physiologists, cellular neuroscientists, as a community, developed tools that are still 20, 30 years later being used routinely to ask questions about synaptic function. During this 10-year period from the late 80s to the late 90s, when there was this hot debate about whether long-term potentiation in the hippocampus is because of an increase in release probability or an increase in postsynaptic sensitivity, there were dozens and dozens of techniques and methods developed to figure out how we can assess the postsynaptic sensitivity of a synapse, how we can assess the probability of release, how we can assess the number of contacts that are being made. And those methods are used now in understanding neural circuits, whether we're interested in how different circuits change or just understanding the basics of how neurons communicate with each other at a cellular level in some new area of the brain or in some new disease state or whatever. And so it's sort of like in the race to prove whether communism or capitalism was the best method for economics, the U.S. and the Soviet Union sort of accidentally built some great rockets that sent people to the moon, and now we have GPS satellites and geostationary orbits and all of these other things that we can, you know, I can tell which side of the street that I'm on by looking at my phone, even if I'm blindfolded or not able to see the world around me or whatever. Because of technology that was developed in an effort to, you know, prove capitalism was the best thing that the world should run on or whatever. And so if you want to understand, as we explore the way these technologies were developed and applied to these problems, I'm hoping to sort of give you insight into how neurobiologists today assess the way synapses function. And then sort of even more broadly than that, and even more broadly than synaptic function, which I get excited about a lot, is sort of science in general. And when I sort of think about this problem and think about this particular question, so I've drawn over here a sort of connection from a CA3 neuron in CA3 area of hippocampus to another neuron in the CA1 area of the hippocampus. And on this connection, I drew two points of contact. But in reality, it's really, really hard to track one axon that far and figure out how many points of contact it makes. There are thousands and thousands of axons interleaved together with each other. They crisscross all over the place. Finding a single cell here and a single one there and figuring out how many points of contact and telling the difference between a time when the axon passes close to the cell versus when it makes a real synaptic connection onto the cell is still very, very hard to do. And so I've drawn this as a connection where the in is 2, but generally speaking, if you're doing an experiment and you have a single cell that you're stimulating and another cell that you're recording from, you don't know before you start what number of contacts there are. You also don't know and can't really directly measure what the probability of release is. If there was only one point of contact, we could, right? You just stimulate it. Stimulate it, wait. Do that 100 times. And then if 60% of the times you got a response and 40% of the times you didn't, and you know there's one contact, then you could say, okay, release probability is 0.6 or 0.4. Anyway, whatever. But if you don't know how many points of contact there are, then as you worked out through that long homework assignment, the number of times that you see nothing is going to be a function of how many contacts there are and the probability of release at each. And so in the number of contacts is this invisible thing that we can't directly measure. Probability of release, unless we know n is 1, which we don't in these experiments that we've been talking about so far, probability of release is an invisible variable. Postsynaptic response, so here, if I stimulate the axon and I get a 2 millivolt response, I don't know if that's because there are 2 points of contact and they both released, or if there are 4 points of contact and 2 of them released, and they're each 1 millivolt, or if there's just 1 point of contact and it has a 2 millivolt response. So I can't tell the difference between a single point of contact with a 2 millivolt response that occurred here versus 2 points of contact that have 1 millivolt each. So these variables are all tied together. If I did it enough times, then I could maybe start to make some inferences, although it turns out that Q is actually more properly the average response, because it turns out that even if there's just one point of contact, biology is noisy and messy, and so even if there's just one point of contact, you're going to get a mean with some variability around that. It's not going to be a perfect 2 millivolts, 2 millivolts, 0 to failure, 2 millivolts, 2 millivolts, 0 to failure. So Q, postsynaptic sensitivity, is also this invisible thing that I can't measure. And so what we're doing here is we are exploring with a concrete question, but getting a sense more broadly of how scientists can make inferences about these invisible 3 variables, or about some set of invisible variables that we can't directly measure, by looking at things that we can measure, and then poking at the system and blocking certain things or changing concentration of calcium maybe or whatever we were going to do, sort of like mess around with things a little bit and see how that changes the responses, and then infer from that what's going on. And so mean, right, so if I simulate a synapse a bunch of times, I can mean I can tell, right? Like that's easy to calculate. That's just the average. So the mean here, I did it four times. I got the mean here is 2 millivolts. Like I can just easily figure out the mean of some set of numbers. That's no trouble. But whether that's because I've got 4 points of contact that each have a 1 millivolt response, and in this sample set sometimes they came together, I'd have to get a lot more data to figure it out, and even then I'd have to start making some assumptions in order to make things work. What we're working through here is really an exercise in how scientists proceed at inferring these invisible variables from things we can measure, like the mean response. Okay, what questions do people have about any of that? Sort of bigger picture perspective on what we're doing with this. Middle of last class, I took a poll. I want to do that again. Again, you can either say you think long-term potentiation is presynaptic. One other reminder. So N is unknown, but we're assuming constant because growing new synapse, constant. Because growing a new connection is slow. Adding more calcium channels onto an existing presynaptic terminal can happen within a few minutes. Adding more AMPA receptors onto an existing postsynaptic dendrite, that can happen in a few minutes. Growing a whole new branch of an axon and making a functional synapse there will take probably a couple hours to accomplish. And so we're assuming that N is going to stay constant. So our choices are either the presynaptic cell starts releasing more glutamate after we give this high-frequency stimulation, and that's why our average goes up, or the postsynaptic cell puts in more AMPA receptors, and that's why our average goes up, or both happen. So take a second to think about what you think that is, and then we'll vote. And again, if I see anybody who doesn't vote, then I get to call on you and ask you why you don't vote. So there's no right or wrong answer, but you have to say something. You have to raise your hand for something. So who thinks it's more release of glutamate coming out of the presynaptic cell? Okay. Who thinks it's more AMPA receptors going into the postsynaptic cell? All right. Lots of people for that one. Who thinks that it's a mix of both? Okay, about a quarter-ish of the class for that. Okay, so the experiment we talked about last time was arguing essentially that it is not an increase in release of glutamate. And the argument goes like this. So normally, postsynaptic response depends on how many AMPA receptors we have there. But they modified things in a couple of ways. First, they got rid of magnesium so that the NMDA receptors can respond. Second, they put on a drug that blocks all the AMPA receptors so the AMPA receptors can't be involved. And so now, all of a sudden, our response depends on still the number of contacts, still the release probability, but now instead of depending on the number of AMPA receptors, it depends on the number of NMDA receptors. And so they said, okay, well, if more glutamate's coming out, then after we strengthen the synapse, after we do our high-frequency stimulation that should strengthen the synapse, then we should see a bigger response through these glutamate-detecting NMDA receptors. But what they observed is that after they did a version of high-frequency stimulation to induce long-term potentiation, they saw no increase in the postsynaptic response. And so their conclusion from that is that it is not an increase in P, an increase in probability of release. They're still working under the assumption that no new synaptic contacts are growing, and in fact, probably if new contacts had grown, then it also would have increased as well here. And so they say, well, then the only thing left that must have happened is there must have been more AMPA receptors, and we don't see them here because we're blocking them. But in other experiments, when we don't block the AMPA receptors, the response does get bigger. And so their conclusion then is that what happened between the baseline and the test period here is that more AMPA receptors got added, but because they got blocked by their drug as soon as they got added, they don't see it. And there is not an increase in glutamate release, or they would have seen that. Okay, so we talked about that one, but in a relatively compressed amount of time toward the end of class last period. So what questions do people still have about that experiment before we move on to the next set of experiments? Yeah? In this experiment only, yes. Everywhere else in the whole semester, Q depends on AMPA and not in MDA because the MDA are plugged. But here and only here, yeah.
And for the NMDA, right?
Yeah.
So NMDA, like the amount of charge you get because of the NMDA, that doesn't change?
Yeah. So, yeah, there's like some parentheticals in the course notes about... in a sense, they got lucky because it's possible that there could have been more NMDA receptors inserted in. And so if things got bigger, they wouldn't be able to rule out a postsynaptic change. It could be more NMDA and more AMPA receptors. And so it could have still been a postsynaptic change. It's actually possible, although it's really super unlikely, and if you can't understand the next sentence, it doesn't matter, but it's possible that probability of release goes up, but some NMDA receptors get removed, and so the mean averages out. That seems super unlikely. And so they're just like, there's some possibilities here, but the most obvious, simple explanation is just there's not extra glutamate coming out. Yeah. Yeah, did you have a question? Yes. And their claim, yeah, that's the whole point of this. Yeah, the title of this paper says LTP is postsynaptic. Yeah. That was somewhere back here. Here, postsynaptic modification. And the argument is not that they observe a postsynaptic change, but that they did an experiment that should have found increased glutamate if it happened, and they didn't see anything. So it's sort of an argument by process of elimination. Other questions about that? Okay, so again, like the data that we have to work with is stuff like this, and then we can summarize it. As our postsynaptic response, our CA1 response in millivolts over time, we can summarize it. Instead of drawing this all the way out to FIPS, we just summarize every time we simulate as a dot. Sometimes there are some zeros, some failures in here. And then there's some mean beforehand. Then at this time point, that's when we do our high frequency stimulation. And then after that, there's maybe a little bit of a period where it's super strong. And then it sort of settles back in. Maybe there's still some failures in there. Something like this, but the mean after versus the mean before has increased. So our mean has gone up. That's the definition of long-term potentiation. Comparing to our baseline or our before period, this is our during period, and then this is our after period. The mean has gone up. The synapse has gotten stronger, and we're trying to figure out why. Which one of these three invisible variables, N, P, and Q, is changing? We've sort of reasoned that N is unlikely to change. It's biologically implausible for N to change. And so we're sort of saying, okay, really, it's P or Q that's changing. So that's the data that we have, right? And from that data, we want to answer this question. And so there was one attempt made by Julie Cower, Rob Malenka, and Roger Nickel that we talked about last time. The next attempt was made by Roberto Malino and Dick Chen. This was published a couple years later in 1990. their, as you can see from the title, their claim is going to be that, in fact, it's a presynaptic change. So long-term potentiation in hippocampal slices, so chunks of hippocampus, when you do this high-frequency stimulation, their claim is going to be that this is because of a presynaptic change. Okay, and so the logic that they used is this. So we know, you all have already worked out that equation is true. The mean response is equal to the number of contacts times the presynaptic probability of release at each contact times the postsynaptic response. To get a functional connection, you need some presynaptic stuff and some postsynaptic stuff. So N depends on both sides. P is all about the presynaptic terminal and calcium coming in and releasing neurotransmitter. Q is all about how many AMPA receptors we have postsynaptically. So in a sense, our debate is, another way to ask your question is it P or is it Q that's changing? And so what Roberto Malano did is that he worked out, if you remember from the homework assignment, that long packet of homework assignments that we had, there was one question that I had where was something like N equals 2, probability of release equals 0.3, postsynaptic sensitivity is, I don't remember, maybe it was 2 millivolts or something like that. And so this works out to be that the mean is equal to 1.2 millivolts. And then there was another case on that same packet where, again, N was 2, probability of release was 0.6, postsynaptic sensitivity was still 2 millivolts, and then the mean there worked out to be 2.4 millivolts. And there was another case also on that homework packet where N equals 2, probability of release is 0.3, postsynaptic sensitivity was 4 millivolts, and again, our mean worked out to be 2.4 millivolts. But one of the questions at the end of the packet asked you, so the means are the same in these two conditions, but if you look back through at the distribution of responses that you got and the individual values that went into those means, the distribution was different. I think an overall broader distribution here, but the distribution here was exactly like the distribution here, just everything multiplied by 2, right? Because whenever there's a response, everything multiplies by 2. Whereas the distribution here had a very different shape to it because the number of failures was different, the proportion of times you got both contacts to release was different, the proportion of times you got just one or the other to release was different. And so if we compare this versus this, it's the same distribution, just everything doubled. And then comparing this versus this, not only the average doubled, but the whole thing shifted around. And we got a sort of different shape to our distribution. And we could plot those out as histograms if we wanted to. But the point being that you can get the same mean, but if you change P, you'll get a different distribution than if you change Q to get that doubling of mean. Does that make sense to everybody? That kind of ringing bells from the homework assignment? So we found two different ways to get to a double, to double our mean, but in doubling our mean, we changed our distribution in different ways. And so there's a measurement that you can take in statistics. If you're looking at a set of data, the first thing you probably do is take the mean of it. The second thing you probably do is do something called taking the standard deviation of it. And I will not be asking you to take standard deviations of anything in this class. The symbol for standard deviation is sigma. And the equation for standard deviation, which you will never have to use in this class, is that sigma equals the sum of each individual point minus the mean squared divided by our number of events. I think I got that right. Sometimes I even, but that's sort of neither here nor there for us. What Roberto Malino worked out is that for a synapse, we can express, just like we expressed our mean in terms of NP and Q, we can express our standard deviation in terms of NP and Q. And our standard deviation ends up equaling Q times N times the square root of N times P times 1 minus P. And the logic behind this, sort of intuitively, is that if you double everything, you're going to get double the standard deviation. That's sort of a, if you just double every value in a distribution, you get double the standard deviation. That's what happened when we changed our Q. So that's why it doesn't have a square root around it. The reason that there's a square root around this has to do with, actually, it's a square root of all of that. It's the standard deviation. Sigma squared is that. Because the individual components are under square root sign here, that's sort of why it works out. I've actually never been able to like derive this myself. If anybody wants to, I'd be happy to give you a bonus point if you can derive this yourself. But I take Roberto Malino's word for it. So as we have more contacts, we're going to have a little bit larger deviation, but it scales with the square root of the number of contacts. If our probability of release is zero, we're never getting anything, then our standard deviation is also going to be zero because we're just getting 0000000000 as our recording, and standard deviation of that is zero. If our probability of release is 100%, then every single time we stimulate, we get the same response, and so there's no variability. So then our standard deviation also goes to zero. You had a question?
Yeah, you're saying about deriving that out. I think that uses a property called equivariance.
Okay. Yeah, well, if you want to send me something or talk with me about it afterwards, I would love to. That would be awesome. Yeah, I've been able to show it works for test cases, but I've never been able to. Anyway, but the important thing about this is that if you give me a bunch of numbers of like all of the responses before, I can take the average of that. If you give me a bunch of numbers, I can put that into Excel and have Excel tell me the standard deviation of that. So mean is a measurable variable. Standard deviation is also an empirically measurable variable, just from looking at the distribution of things. And if I have two things that I can measure, I can also start doing algebra with them. There happens to be a value in something in statistics called the coefficient of variation. Which is sometimes abbreviated CV. We're just going to call it V for short, coefficient of variation. Coefficient of variation is just equal to standard deviation divided by mean. And so again, I have something I can measure. I have something else I can measure. I can divide them by each other. That's no problem. For sort of reasons that we can get into at some other time if people are interested in, it turns out that because there's square roots here, it's kind of a pain in the butt to deal with square roots. And so we can just as easily square this, sigma squared over mean squared. Again, I can measure these, I can square them, Excel can do it for me, whatever. And then also turns out that that the more common measurement that people use is 1 over the coefficient of variation squared, or coefficient of variation to the minus 2, if you remember your rules of exponents, which is just this divided by this. Doesn't really matter about all of that. The point being that if you give me a set of numbers during the baseline, and then you say, okay, this is the distribution of values I got during the baseline, this is the distribution of values I got after I induced LTP. I can put those into Excel. Excel can tell me the mean. Excel can tell me the standard deviation. I can square the mean. I can square the standard deviation. I can divide them by each other. And if we do some algebra on this, what we will work out, I'll leave this as an exercise for people to work out the fine details, is that this is n times p over 1 minus p. So, why the heck did we just spend 7 minutes doing all of that? There's something really handy about this. So again, I can experimentally calculate this, right? I can experimentally measure that if you give me a set of data. I can experimentally measure this. These things are hidden from me. N, P, and Q are hidden from me. But if I see a change in mean and no change in 1 over coefficient of variation squared, then there's only, well, assuming N and P aren't both changing in some conspiratorial way, there's only really one variable that can change. So for example, I do an experiment. The mean doubles, but the inverse square of the coefficient of variation stays constant. Which of my hidden variables change in that experiment? So, yeah, Q, right, exactly. So, Q is fortunately absent from this expression. And so, if we see a change in mean, but not a change in coefficient of variation, then we can safely conclude that the hidden variable that changed was Q, our postsynaptic number of AMPA receptors. Questions about that? Okay, so let's take the next 3 minutes, talk to whoever's next to you, and say, so if we see a change in coefficient, if we see a change in mean and also a change in coefficient of variation, given also the, some of the assumptions that we're working under, what does that tell us about what's going on? So we see mean increases and coefficient of variation changes. Then what is that? So what's going to be our conclusion from that? Change in both mean and inverse square of coefficient of variation, what the conclusion, the inference is going to be? Sure, yeah.
Well, if mean increases, then the probability will
not increase. Yeah, so right, so one of these things had to increase. And maybe Q changed. We can't tell anything about Q from our coefficient of variation. But for sure, either N or P changed. Why did you think not N?
Well, because we said that in this little amount of time that we could have grown more.
Yeah. So if we're still sort of working with this, where you got this idea that we're not going to change more, we're not growing more things, there's not enough time to do that. So again, sort of by kind of process of elimination, we're left with P is the thing that changed, if this is what we observe. Okay, and so before we see the actual data, they did sort of a reality check on themselves, which is to say, okay, there's sort of a lot of math that we went through and even more math that we didn't go through behind all of this logic. So if we go back, we look at our synaptic connection, voltage-activated calcium channels, and then vesicles over here, all filled with neurotransmitter. And then over here we've got our postsynaptic cell with some AMPA receptors, some NMDA receptors that are plugged up with that magnesium ion. And so when we get an action potential here, calcium comes in, binds to these vesicles, we get fusion and release of glutamate that binds to our AMPA receptors, and then sodium comes in over here. That's sort of the basics of synaptic transmission back from unit one. The probability comes into whether or not the calcium manages to find a vesicle or not. That's sort of the step that is involved in probability. So if we have more calcium available outside the cell that can flow in, it's going to flow in at a faster rate. And so if we put extra calcium out here, then more calcium comes in, and we're going to have a higher probability of release. So extra calcium out here gives us an increase in P. Notice, this is something that is often confusing for people. Notice that right now, in this setup, our NMDA receptors are plugged up. So we are not getting any calcium coming in to the postsynaptic cell. The fact that we've added extra calcium outside doesn't matter to our postsynaptic cell, because the only avenue the calcium has to get in is plugged up through this entire experiment. So it's only the fact that the presynaptic cell is getting calcium in, and that we've put more calcium there to get into the presynaptic cell. So if this is all correct, then when we put more calcium outside, we should see an increase in the mean response. And sure enough, this is sort of all of what they see. There's a spread of responses. A lot of times where there's a failure, they add some more calcium. The mean of that changes. And over here, they're plotting in circles over time the mean. And so the mean goes up. And then in triangles, the coefficient of the inverse square of the coefficient of variation, mean squared over sigma squared. And so coefficient of variation also goes up. So just as we expected from the math, when we do something that's going to change probability of release, we get an increase in both mean and coefficient of variation. Yeah?
Is there any calcium
in the No. Not, yeah. There are some cells where that happens, but not in these cells. And forget I said that. But yeah. Because the voltage-activated calcium channels are every action potential. Those open up and let calcium into the presynaptic cell. So that's always going to be working. Yeah. 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 That's a very important distinction. Other questions about that part so far? Okay. Then they sort of stole, or kind of took advantage of one of the same things that Julie Cower and Rob Malenka and Roger Nickel took advantage of, which is this drug CNQX that blocks AMPA receptors. But they did it in sort of a different way. So I'll redraw this over here. So again, we've got our voltage-activated calcium channels, vesicles, and you know, something fuses, neurotransmitter comes out. In Julie Cower's experiment, they put on a high concentration of CNQX that just blocked completely all the AMPA receptors. They saturated their cells with CNQX and blocked all the AMPA receptors. In this case, here, let me just sort of keep it consistent. At any given synapse, there are going to be 50 or so AMPA receptors. And so what they did here in this experiment, what Roberto Malino is doing in this experiment, is putting on a low dose of CNQX, just enough to block some of the AMPA receptors, but leave some of them unaltered. Again, our NMDA receptors are out of the picture because they're plugged up by that magnesium ion. And so what this is... So, low dose of CNQX that is going to block some but not all AMPA receptors. This is a manipulation that's going to bring down our postsynaptic sensitivity. And so our mean should go down if we're bringing down our postsynaptic sensitivity. And you can see already that it does. But if they're right, the inverse square of the coefficient of variation should not. And so they plot it again over here. So when we increase calcium, mean goes up. When we put on the drug that blocks some of our AMPA receptors, mean goes back down. So that's sort of expected. But again, as they expected from their math, When they change presynaptic probability by adding calcium, mean goes up. When they change postsynaptic sensitivity by blocking, inverse square coefficient variation goes up. When they change postsynaptic sensitivity by blocking some of the AMPA receptors, the inverse square of the coefficient variation stays exactly where it was before they added that drug. So that changes the mean without changing the coefficient variation. And so what they've done here is done something. This is not LTP. We have done no high frequency stimulation. We haven't zapped the heck out of a synapse yet. We're just kind of playing around with it. And we play around with it in a way that we know is going to change P. And as predicted, that changes both mean and inverse square of coefficient of variation. Then we play around with it in another way that we know is going to change Q. And as predicted, that changes mean but leaves coefficient of variation alone. And so this is, again, sort of acting as a reality check. The math works in an empirical situation such that our measure of inverse square of coefficient of variation is reliably telling us when P changes and reliably not changing if we mess with Q. Okay, so what questions do people have about all of that? Okay, so now to the data for this paper. So looking at the distribution. So as I mentioned, biology is less perfect than some of the examples I draw up there. But when they stimulate a presynaptic terminal, this is all in sort of a baseline period, sometimes they get failures. Other times they get responses. Those responses have distributions of amplitudes. There's maybe sometimes a phi. There's some spread in those distributions. There's some noise that I don't show in a lot of my examples. But yeah, so they can measure these responses. Actually, they go down because of something about the way that they're doing their recording, which is sort of a backwards form of recording that is measuring currents in an inverse way. So these are excitatory events, even though they go down, because they're measuring, they're holding the cell. What they do is an experiment is a manipulation where they force the cell's membrane potential to stay constant, and then they measure the external current they have to apply to keep it constant. So if positive ions come into the cell, they need to put negatives in to counteract it. And so that's why excitation looks like it going down. That's kind of not really critical for this. The important thing just being that we're measuring the size of the response before versus the size of the response after is what we're really interested in. And the distribution of the responses before versus the distribution of the responses after. Okay, so during their baseline period, they measure about 100 trials. They get a mean. And they can also get a coefficient of variation from that, and flip it over and square it if they want to. You know, do whatever algebra they feel like to it. Then at this arrow, now that represents the time when they give this high frequency stimulation to zap the heck out of things. During that time, and only during that time, the NMDA receptors are unplugged, letting magnesium is gone, letting calcium in, and then they want you to think that what happens then is some signal goes back to the presynaptic terminal to increase release. And then afterwards, they go back to measuring, and they get this broad distribution of responses. The mean is clearly higher, and then they're going to calculate in the next figure, the inverse square of the coefficient of variation. Okay, again, so here now, this is the raw data of individual dots, every dot representing one time that they stimulated this connection. We can then summarize this over time by taking averages over longer periods of time and looking at those. So this was an experiment where they did LTP. There were other cells that they just left alone just to make sure that nothing naturally changes over time. So if they have a cell and they just leave it alone and keep stimulating the synapse once at a time, never do a high frequency stimulation, the mean never goes up, the coefficient of variation never changes. So all that control is telling us is that our synapse isn't changing if we don't mess with it. But then if they give a high frequency stimulation, the mean goes up. That's a good thing. That's LTP. That's what we wanted to have happen. If that didn't happen, then something just wasn't working for them. So that's the definition of long-term potentiation, is that the mean increased after this high-frequency stimulation. But then by their logic and by their reasoning and based on the sort of reality checks and everything they've done, if this increase in mean were because of an increase in Q, then coefficient of variation, inverse square of coefficient of variation, variance is actually the same thing as sigma squared. Inverse square of coefficient of variation should stay flat. If it's postsynaptic, then that should stay flat because Q doesn't factor into that equation. But if it's presynaptic, then there should be a change. And in fact, they observe a change, and therefore they infer and conclude that P, which they can't measure directly, but they can make inferences about based on the logic that they've got, has changed. And that is why the synapse changes strength, and that's why they come to the conclusion that this long-term potentiation is presynaptic. Okay. All right. So that's one of the hardest, possibly the hardest paper in this whole set to digest. So what questions do people have about that whole study? How they got to their conclusions? Yeah. Oh, paired, it's a version of high frequency stimulation where you're actually putting action potentials into both cells simultaneously. So you're depolarizing the postsynaptic cell to relieve the magnesium. I'm sorry, what? So it's around this before, and then it jumps up to 2.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Okay, so there's homework due Wednesday on Blackboard. And if you didn't turn in your exam reflections on your way in, please turn those in on your way out. Yeah, if anyone has questions, you can...